praise, glory, honor, love, and reverence for Yahweh, our Elohim, our Mighty One, our Father, the Creator of the universe, previously known as the Lord our God, and His Son, Yahushua HaMashiach, the Messiah, the Savior of the universe, previously known as Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Once upon a time, in a land not so far away, there lived a young man by the name of Romeo, whose only wish was to love another with all of his heart. As well in his heart was his desire to see his dream of a renaissance, born in Providence. United States of America. A new world order achieved at all costs.
Bigger pictures analysis section of the program, the broadcast, and this is basically meant to highlight different aspects of this project that I've been working on for quite some time. That's, you know, essentially complete at this point. So this is really about kind of walking people through different aspects of the production film slash book slash multimedia presentation on the website www.providencerenaissance.com. This is really all about making sure that we're, I just want to get this information out the door and kind of walk through people through the different aspects. It's fairly complex. There's a story that kind of holds it all together, but it also has various documentary elements, multimedia elements, and historical elements, and autobiographical elements, but it definitely hits upon a lot of major areas of our society to kind of expose certain things. So, and it hits it from kind of certain angles, I guess you can say, is the best way. Like, for example, you have the character Rockefeller Monticello, who's Mr. Old Money Newport, and he lives in this Newport mansion with his wife, who drinks a lot, and he represents essentially the elite, the upper echelon of society. He's Mr. International Banker / Oil Man, and there's, you know, that kind of commentary on that reality. But then there's also these documentary sequences or animation sequences that go into modern day Wall Street and the multinational corporations and international banking empires that make up Wall Street and the different components, and you know how that fits into this whole kind of fabric of our American culture and world culture, and the reality of, you know, the oligopolistic structure of Wall Street, and so, you know, that's another way of looking at it. There's, you know, these satirical scenes, these little animation sequences, all these things, right? It's painting a picture, but it's painting a picture from different angles. So this is another version of that. So, for example, you know, obviously we have the mafia in modern day society, and you know, it's generally speaking pretty tame, I think, in the U.S. at this point, like because of all the public upheaval through the past century, really, with all the killings and all the corruption and you know, all the drug distribution and you name it with the mafia, and people just had enough. You know, they don't, you know, so a lot of those people, the main figureheads, are in prison, or maybe they ran off to some other foreign country somehow and got away. I don't know. But it's definitely not what it was. Basically, what's outlined in, you know, different shows like Boardwalk Empire and HBO shows the mafia and organized crime and how it formulated over time and back in the time of Prohibition in New York City and Atlantic City and in Chicago, and how it definitely was forming as a result of the response to Prohibition. The Prohibition of alcohol led to all these bootlegging operations and Al Capone and all this under this kind of subculture of organized crime that manifested. But, you know, I mean, crime has been around forever. Corruption has been around forever. All these different vices have been around forever. The mafia definitely did a very good job in the 20th century of basically fine-tuning the control of the operations of vice and pornography and gambling and things of that nature, and drug distribution, alcohol distribution, and all kinds of things. But, you know, we also have, for example, like the Gangs of New York kind of shows how gangs formed, maybe leading into the mafia organizations of New York, the five families. So in Providence, for example, so this is, there's a character, which I'm going to show you shortly, which is based on, he's obviously a very kind of exaggerated, ridiculous version of a godfather figure, but the mafia, Italian mafia, in Rhode Island, at least in all of New England, its headquarters of the New England crime family at one point was the Patriarca crime family, which is technically still the major crime family, but the patriarch of the Patriarca crime family, Raymond Patriarca, you know, passed away, died in, you know, 1980s, I think. I'm not sure, but he had a headquarters at the Coin-O-Matic storefront, which I guess had all kinds of pinball machines, cigarette machines, things like that. And I guess he used to sit out in front of the Coin-O-Matic on like a lawn chair with a big long cigarette holder with cigarette. I guess trying to be like John Barrymore or something like that. But he was a notorious crime lord, crime figure. He, you know, had I think it was Bevilacqua, was a chief justice of the state Supreme Court in his back pocket. He had different politicians in his back pocket. He ruled the New England crime family from Federal Hill, which is the an Italian district, not the only Italian district in Providence, but it was Atwell's Ave was, you know, essentially, you know, if you want to call it a mafia HQ. Definitely mafia HQ, a lot of Italian restaurants. They have this, I don't know, Columbus Day Parade that goes through there, all kinds of stuff. But it's definitely Italian HQ. A lot of Italian Roman Catholic people that live and work there. So, you know, he ran all of New England. You know, he essentially represented maybe what would be considered like the sixth family. Like, there's the five families of Mafia, Lucchese, Genovese. I don't know. I have it in my little documentary. The Gambino family. I don't know. I have it all laid out, and I'm going to show it to you. But so he was like the unofficial sixth family, the patriarch or crime family. So I want to kind of get into that. So anyway, this character, it's meant to represent maybe the kind of like making fun of that whole reality, but it's also kind of meant to, you know, scare people from participating in organized crime and or any kind of crime or, you know, participating in a drug related lifestyle, you know, alcohol and gambling and things like that. And it's just more poking fun, if anything. So just want to get into that. So I'm just going to show you Don Malvolio, the local godfather of Federal Hill. And this is Don Malvolio Speaks. So this is an introduction to Don Malvolio in the story. So he's shown his face for the first
time. Italian restaurant, Morning Time. Don Malvolio, the local godfather of Federal Hill, is seated at a table with hookers and lackeys surrounding him as he gorges himself on sausages and ham and eggs and bacon, guzzling wine like the gluttonous slob that he is. He has dark black sunglasses, a black suit, black shirt and tie, greasy black hair, and black pointy eyebrows. Lackey number one. Don Malvolio, I need your help with something.
I am Don Malvolio! I do nothing for you! I am Satan in the flesh! An abomination! I am rotten to the core! I own all the strip clubs, their hookers, their pawn shops, the casinos, the liquor stores. I sell all the drugs! I love real estate, yes. I own almost all the Renaissance City! I pay off politicians and the policemen and extort the money from local business people in exchange for my benevolence, or rather, benevolence protection, yes!
He laughs wickedly with yellow fang teeth and black eyes.
I do nothing for nobody! You must do for me! Get away from me! I put the hit out on you! I don't like you!
He turns to the hitman standing beside him.
I want you to kill this man!
Vic the hitman. But boss, so, you know, he's your nephew.
But I put the hit out on you too! Nobody questions the authority of Don Malvolio! And lives to tell about it. Wait, Pettyhead, I put the hit out on all of you! You are nothing compared to Don Malvolio! Ah! You do not even deserve to live in the same world as me! Ah!
All right, so we saw Mr. Don Malvolio. All right, so up next, we're going to get into another different way of looking at that same kind of reality. So the Vatican's Pentagon and CIA is something that I want to kind of touch upon because, you know, this it goes into other areas of this reality. So
in our wonderful military that is used to attack, invade, rape and pillage, ravage and plunder, and utterly annihilate by extreme force any nation that stands in the way of the implementation of the new world.
So we're gonna skip a little ahead, and that's the Vatican's Pentagon / CIA. It's definitely pretty interesting, but the last part gets into the reality, in my opinion, of the war in Afghanistan. I think it was largely about really control over the opium trade, opium is processed into heroin, which, you know, is obviously something that has been distributed worldwide through sources like the Mafia in Sicily and places like that. So this kind of gives like a kind of overview of the Jesuit assistant assassin, West Europe assistancy commandery, is one of the individuals. This breaks down the Jesuit hierarchical structure worldwide, where the Jesuit order, which I consider to be like the Vatican's Pentagon and / CIA, their headquarters in the Borgo San Spirito, which is right down the street from the Vatican. You know, they are historically a very notorious group. And the International Military Order of the Society of Jesus. They've been kicked out of 70 different countries. They effectively are the black hand behind many historical events over the past 500 years. They were formed by Ignatius de Loyola to destroy the Protestant Reformation, which was formed. So they were formed in 1534, I believe, off the top of my head. So their whole purpose was to essentially create what's called the Counter-Reformation, right? To counter this whole movement started by people like Martin Luther, John Calvin, to stand up against the church, or the all-powerful church, right? The Roman Catholic Empire, the unholy Roman Empire, whatever you want to call it, really a continuation of the ancient Roman Empire. You know, Caesars became popes, right? So all of a sudden in the 1500s, but leading up into the 1500s, there were a lot of issues that people were standing up against the church. They didn't want, even rulers at the time, kings were standing up against the church, and they didn't want to be ruled by the Vatican, right? So you started getting this basically this great awakening happening. And, you know, with people like Martin Luther translating the Bible and all of a sudden people could read the Bible, which is like a total revolution. I mean, the Protestant Reformation is the cornerstone of modern civilization. And any democratic society, constitutional republic in the form of the United States, the realities that we live in, the Bill of Rights of different countries and things of that nature, any constitutional liberties, I mean, it's all born out of the Protestant Reformation. I mean, if it wasn't for Protestant Reformation, you know, this broadcast probably would never have happened. And, you know, America would never have happened. America is literally the last frontier of the Protestant Reformation and really a representation of a continuation of that theme of the Protestant Reformation, freedom. And, you know, the middle class essentially exists because of the Protestant Reformation. Prior to that, you had lords and serfs, you know, and tradespeople. And essentially it was, you know, very, very oppressed reality for a lot of people. So anyway, so the Jesuits, you know, their whole the formation of the Jesuits was all about destroying the Protestant Reformation, reclaiming what was lost during the Protestant Reformation in terms of power and control at the hands of the church. And they exist to this day. They are so far behind the scenes that you probably never even heard about it, but they still exist. I mean, their universities, colleges are positioned, you can call them military fortresses, whatever you want to call them, all over the planet. There are assistants that control essentially 1/10 of the planet. I think there's normally 10 different assistancies, and it's all basically taking the entire planet, subdividing it down, and having an assistant per subdivision of globe. And then you have provincials, provocateurs, quote unquote, who have, you know, govern essentially by, you know, a form of kind of Roman provincial government over these certain smaller subsectors of those particular larger regions. So this essentially what this kind of puts into perspective is the fact that, you know, you have Jesuit Georgetown University right there in the heart of our nation's capital, and then you have the Pentagon right across the river, and, you know, so many people are transition from the universities into the Vatican's for the Pentagon and the CIA and other different intelligence agencies and military agencies all over the planet. So that's, you know, getting a little too far ahead of myself with what I'm presenting, but this is just a little quick snapshot. So there are people that are pulling the strings behind the scenes, and the Jesuits are definitely some of those people that are, and there's very influential people. The head of the Superior General of the Order, the Superior General of the International Military Order of the Society of Jesus, also known as the Black Pope, is an extremely powerful person. I mean, right now, historically, you never had a Jesuit Pope until the last few years. So you had the Jesuit White Pope, representing the sun god figure and occult circles. And then you have, behind the scenes, the Jesuit Black Pope, which, you know, the dynamic duo at this time is, you have Arturo Sosa. He's from Venezuela, so he has, that background. So he's the current Superior General Black Pope, Arturo Sosa. And he was an assistant assassin, as I call them, of, I believe it was Northern or Central America and Northern South America, or maybe all of South America. So, all right. So we're just going to go through, and this is, this is a little outdated. Hold on one sec. I'm going to start that over. But so basically, this is kind of an overview showing kind of top down perspective of who's really in charge. You know, you have essentially with the Jesuits, you have a subdivision of the globe into, you know, 10 divisions. And you also have that simultaneously with the U.S. Pentagon, which has the world subdivided into these different commanderies, basically command centers. And, you know, for example, you have the U.S. Central Command, which is like the Middle East, and they have U.S. Africa Command, which literally has the image of the continent of Africa for their logo, which commands all of Africa. And then you have the U.S. Southern Command, which has the entire continent of South America as their logo. And then NORTHCOM, the U.S. Northern Command, which, you know, is the North American continent. So this is an illustration of essentially the Eastern European component leading into the Middle Eastern component, and the different figures and assistants, and, you know, the way it's essentially structured is the best way to put it. It's top down, but it's really kind of goes sideways. You'll see. And I use this approach because I wasn't sure how to really do it any other way without doing it in some kind of, like, I don't know, three-dimensional kind of format. So this is really just a sequence that, you know, technically could be looked at from the top down, but it shows side to side, so left to right, and it has titles and different logos. And but ultimately, this is, again, getting back to the mafia, showing kind of a breakdown of the influence of the mafia, and also tying in the Vatican. You have obviously this sequence over here, the Vatican Vampire Bank. So I want to go back to this. So it's just to kind of capture maybe the essence of the war in Afghanistan and into that whole thing. So just want to go back a little bit.
Don't kill the yellow man.
All right. So that, you know, kind of broke down everything, you know, in terms of, you know, you get the heroin over here in Afghanistan, and then ends up in Sicily, which, you know, maybe there's a lot more to it. I really don't care. I think this is just like a kind of broad brushstroke overview. You know, is Colombia the cocaine capital of the world? I believe so. I think that's pretty known thing at this point. It's pretty defined. You know, is Venezuela the drug distribution capital of the world? I don't know. But I'm just really just painting a picture, generally speaking, of, you know, this whole process. Things start here. You know, there's these different groups involved, the drug cartels over here in Mexico, Venezuela, Colombia. You have the mafia in Sicily. You have, you know, obviously the, you know, the war in Afghanistan, you know, controlling maybe the opium trade, essentially, is what I think that war was all about. But, you know, this whole fighting the Taliban charade, you know, I mean, they definitely were there, and they definitely are still there, and it's unfortunate. But so this is just really more kind of broader brushstroke, kind of painting a picture of, you know, how drugs are distributed worldwide, and really the power of the mafias and those different venues. And then you see at the very end, it had a sequence where it shows all the different, you have Afghanistan, opium capital of the world, and then over here, and then the Vatican Bank, which historically has been used to launder drug money, heroin money, the IOR, Institute of Religious Works, which, I don't know, right? Institute of Corruption, or whatever. But, so then you have, obviously, the five families in New York. You have the Archbishop of New York, who, in essence, is has been called the American Pope, you know, the head of America. You have the Al Smith dinner that happens after a president's newly elected, and usually both, or normally speaking, both candidates would be there. You know, the one dummy candidate on the one side, and then the one that was chosen to be the next president on the other side of the equation. And then you have the Archbishop of New York City as the king, the American Pope, sitting in between the two candidates, and then they yuck it up and have a kind of roasting session. Like, for example, Trump roasted Hillary Clinton. This is all at the Waldorf Astoria, one of the most luxurious hotels on the planet. And this is, you know, this is where the elite gather, you know, to get, you know, instructions from their leader, you know, their the head of the U.S., really, the American Pope. I mean, you have all these different popes, or sorry, presidents that have their picture taken with this individual. You know, once upon a time, there was Archbishop Cardinal Spellman, Francis Cardinal Spellman, who is the Archbishop of New York City, which, you know, effectively ran this country. He was the head of the country, behind the scenes, of course, you know, the American Pope. So there's a picture of a very famous picture of him. Same scenario, Al Smith dinner, post-election, where you have the dummy candidate. In that case, it was Nixon, Richard Nixon, and then you had John F. Kennedy, who became the president. And you have Archbishop Francis Cardinal Spellman behind the scenes, the, you know, their essential master. You know, and it's just from a certain perspective, if you believe that to be true, and the infiltration of the Jesuit order and the Catholic Church over time into this country, and the manipulation behind the scenes, and the absolute control and domination of institutions like the Vatican, or sorry, the Pentagon and the CIA. And, you know, it really just depends on your perspective. Nancy Pelosi was the Speaker of the House for, seemed like an eternity. She was a very devout Catholic, went to the Vatican quite often, She wanted to step down from being the Speaker of the House and wanted to essentially be the ambassador to the Vatican from that meets with the president and whoever else. So, again, you know, behind the scenes, I mean, it really just takes a small handful of individuals to hand over power, you know, push through massive pieces of legislation, and which she did like heroically over time. You know, everybody just follows suit. You know, they don't want to go against the grain. They want to play follow the leader and do whatever. So one individual that's compromised, like a Speaker of the House, a very powerful person politically, obviously, and you know, they can push through any type of legislation, completely transform this country through endless laws and legislation that have been, you know, just processed and over time. So, you know, supposedly she has connections to the mafia, and definitely Biden obviously is very devout Catholic. He's met with the Pope many times. This Pope, the previous Pope, who's been to the Vatican multiple times. So he had, doesn't show on his Wikipedia anymore, but he had two honorary degrees from Jesuit colleges, universities. I think it was like St. Joseph College and St. Louis University off the top of my head. But anyway, so this is the last sequence, and this is specifically about the Vatican Vampire Bank. I call the Vatican Vampire City. I feel that these people, my cat, these people, you know, are vampires. I mean, they look like vampires. They prey on little children. You know, they're notorious pedophiles, these cardinals and popes and other religious officials, bishops and priests. And, you know, they're vampires. So we have Vampire City. And they dress up in these scarlet cloaked outfits, and they literally look like vampires. So there you go. You have Vatican Vampire Bank, Vampire City. Right, which is the, you know, money laundering financial institution of the universe. So,
if the Vatican ever did an inventory of their wealth or liquidated all of its assets, third world poverty would be instantaneously eradicated.
So there you have it. I think that was pretty interesting way of looking at it from like three different angles. You know, you have Mr. Caricature of Wickedness over here, Mr. Don Malvolio. Yeah, Vatican Vampire Bank, you know, the most corrupt institution in the history of the planet. Vatican's Pentagon / CIA, which kind of breaks down, you know, the overall structure in essence of the mafia. You got the five families of work, and it kind of goes backwards from there. You know, the Sicilian component, the Vatican component, the, you know, the drug source component with this, you know, facade of a war in Afghanistan to, you know, fuel really any number of other projects and agendas of the planet in terms of, you know, manipulating societies and implementing basically a new world order. And it's, you know, drug sales and, you know, corruption of individuals is a great way of going about that, I guess. You know, I guess, you know, it helps to fuel different agendas, and, you know, obviously a world empire is being implemented, and many civilizations and little microcultures are being destroyed in the process. And you know, it's a multifaceted endeavor. You know, you have this war, which is a total facade, you know, a way of disguising, you know, what's happening in the background. You don't know what the right hand is doing over here if you're constantly looking at the left hand, right? Over here, some crazy stuff going on, but, you know, you're just focused on this, you know, that's it. That's all you see. You don't see what's going on behind the scenes. So, I don't know, that's just me piecing it together. But then a lot of the material I drew from in creating these little collage sequences, I guess you could call it, was really a lot of stuff that from people, caricatures, cartoons that people had drawn that, you know, articulated a certain way of looking at the world, you know, that this war in Afghanistan was really all about opium. You know, it was an opium war, another one of the historical opium wars. So, you know, I'm not the only person to look at it like that. So it's interesting when you start, when I was doing these little research scenarios and getting all this information, putting it all together and creating these little collage sequences, that, you know, I was just finding stuff online. You know, I pulled from a lot of different sources, but I would just stumble upon things all the time, you know, like, wow, that's like perfect. You know, just like a little, and it's amazing. Like just the one image and says so much, or just has like some little basic phrases or something. And it says so much in these sequences, that, but you know, it just seemed like it was just meant to be when I was creating this overall project. So, I just want to, you know, share that with the world, and I think is an interesting way to go about it, with this little three trifecta. It's a trifecta, the gambling term, but this trifecta of the mafia, essentially, kind of looking at it from different angles, which, you know, I think is, you know, really the way to do it, because it's not something you can kind of pinpoint, say, oh, it's one person's responsible for it, or this other person, and that's it. It's very complex, you know. Then you tie in intelligence agencies and military organizations and wars that are essentially facades to disguise certain activities, covert operations. I mean, it gets very complicated. So stuff, it's hard to kind of almost visualize, but I think, you know, I did fairly well, you know, articulating it in the collage sequences and showing these different components of the whole thing. And then obviously, you know, just say, for example, if this is still the case in the U.S., if the mafia still controls, you know, just say the heroin trade, for example, there is connections to, you know, as far as distribution of that heroin to the different biker gangs. So I had that at the very end of the sequence. Like over here. Dogs end up getting, you know, funneled down to these distribution components, these different distribution nodes, I guess you can say, in this whole network of the distribution of drugs. I mean, they have to get around somehow. You know, there's different ways that they're distributed, and biker gangs are definitely a great way of distributing illegal drugs. So that's one component. Obviously, marijuana is essentially legal in what, half the country at this point. So we're not really, I don't think law enforcement's that concerned at this point with marijuana, at least. I mean, cocaine is definitely a huge problem, and that's definitely just constantly flowing into the states one way or another. And I mean, who knows? You know, I mean, maybe you get the good side of the DEA and then the dark side of the DEA. The DEA that's tries to prevent drugs from being distributed, and the one that's responsible for the drugs being distributed. So who knows? I don't know all the details. I mean, plenty of stuff has has come to the surface with these types of activities, and it definitely is a way of destroying people's lives, and it's they're doing a great job of it. And if the Jesuits are at the very top behind the scenes, which I'm pretty convinced of, they are geniuses at destroying people's lives and destroying civilization. So, you know, yeah, keep up the good work, I guess. Not, but anyway, so I just want to share that, and I came out pretty good. I wasn't sure what I wanted to share today, but so anyway, www.providencerenaissance.com. It's the headquarters of the modern day Protestant Reformation, which I don't think is going to be as effective as when the Messiah returns to destroy the force of evil once and for all. So anyway, in the meantime, I'm trying to do my part. So hope you have a